Hello everyone. So in this video we are going to look at the kinetic theory of gases, which we can also in short call as KTG. Thing is, you know, the kinetic theory of gases is in one way related to both our thermal properties of matter as well as the thermodynamics part. So we'll have some correlations. I'll tell you, like, you know, wherever we have correlations with the thermal properties and wherever we have correlations with thermodynamics, we'll discuss about it. And even like if you look at advanced J advanced questions, right, that is the reason why we mostly see the KTG concepts linked to thermodynamics, and we'll have questions like, you know, combined questions will come. Okay, so we'll begin the discussion. The kinetic theory of gases, right, is where we'll talk about, I mean, from the name itself, right, because there is also one more analogous chapter in chemistry, which is the states of matter. States of matter, the idea is to broadly study about the gaseous state and the liquid state, because there is one more chapter in chemistry called as solid state. But here in the kinetic theory of gases, we'll focus mostly on the micro level assumptions. I mean, the theory itself is what? It's a set of assumptions, the micro level assumptions, which will help us to understand the macro behavior of gases. So what do you mean by macro behavior? Like when you talk about the gas properties, right, pressure, like, you know, we'll start discussing about the gas properties or gas parameters, like, you know, pressure, because if you keep the gas in a container, means the gas molecules will exert a pressure on the walls of the container. Temperature, volume means we'll take the volume of the container. Number of moles of the gas or mass, which represents the quantity of the gas. Similarly, the density and molar mass, all these are what the parameters or the properties of the gas. These will talk about the macro properties, right? Now we have three things that we will broadly look at in terms of the macro behavior of the gases. One is the gas laws, Boyle's law, Charles' law, the combination of all these gas laws, which culminates into the ideal gas equation. Then we have the diffusion law. Diffusion or effusion is a phenomenon shown by the gases, the diffusion law. Then we have Dalton's law of partial pressures. So where we will talk about the mixture of gases, how they will exert the pressure. Okay, these three are the things that we will mostly focus on in terms of the macro behavior of the gases. To explain the macro behavior, right, we have the micro level assumptions. That is what is mostly the chapter is about, the kinetic gas theory assumptions. Okay, so we'll start the discussion. So beginning with the gas laws, right, we have Boyle's law, which is for the gas, a fixed amount of gas means number of moles is fixed. Similarly, the temperature is also fixed. So for a fixed amount of gas or given mass of gas at constant temperature, the volume is inversely proportional to pressure. Means what? Volume is proportional to 1 by P. We can also write it like this, P proportional to 1 by V. And if you rearrange the means, we can write it like what? If you bring the P to the left side, means it will come to the numerator, right? P into V will be constant. Like if you have a state 1 and state 2, here the product of pressure and volume, P1, V1, that will be exactly equal to what? The product of pressure and volume in the state 2. What is a state? State means the representation of the properties of the gas. About state, right, we will discuss in detail in thermodynamics. In thermodynamics chapter, we will talk about what do you mean by the state of the gas. So state of the gas is represented by the values of the gas parameters. So look at this is an important relation that will be useful for us in terms of solving questions. Since for the Boyle's law, we have to maintain the temperature constant, right? That is the reason why we also refer to it as the isothermal process, because we have to maintain the temperature. Whenever temperature is constant, right, we call it as what? Isothermal. Now we can represent the Boyle's law behavior using graph. All these graph, right? We call them as isotherms. Why? Because we are maintaining the temperature to be constant. Iso means constant. Therm means what? Refers to temperature. So see here, what is the relation we have? Pressure into volume is equal to constant. So what do we have? P is equal to some constant by V. So it's like what? P is equal to constant C by V. This is like what? Y is equal to M by X. It will be a decreasing curve. Look at this. As V is increasing, pressure will be decreasing. When finally V becomes infinity, right? Pressure will become what? Zero. So the decreasing curve will touch the x-axis where at infinity. So this is what is the PV graph. It will be decreasing. If you try to plot P versus 1 by V, look at this. Now if you look at it like this, P is equal to some constant into 1 by V, right? So if your x coordinate is 1 by V, then it is like what? Y is equal to M into X. It will be a straight line passing through horizon. If you are looking at P into V is constant, right? Whatever the volume or pressure values, P into V will be maintained constant. I mean, under the Boyle's law conditions, which is for a given amount of gas, if you maintain the temperature to be constant. So if you try to plot the product of pressure and volume against pressure, we can even plot the product of pressure and volume against volume. Both the cases, the graph is going to be what? Horizontal straight line. Okay, so this is how we can represent the Boyle's law behavior in terms of the graph. All these are called as what? Isotherms. Why we call them as isotherms? Because here we maintain the temperature to be constant. Now the second gas law is Charles' law. So this is again for a given mass of gas, means we are keeping number of moles to be fixed. Okay, if pressure is kept constant, means we are also keeping the pressure constant. So if you keep the number of moles fixed, pressure fixed, right, then the volume will be increasing linearly with the temperature. So means if you look at the temperature to be in the absolute scale or Kelvin scale, right, volume of the gas will be directly proportional to what? Temperature. Of course, here we have to keep in mind that we are talking about what? Pressure to be constant. We can also write it like this. If you bring the temperature to the left side, right, how we can change it? V by T will be constant. Like the previous discussion, right, if you have a state 1 where the volume is V1 and temperature T1, the ratio of volume temperature, right, will be equal to, in state 2 the volume, let us say, is V2 and temperature T2. So V1 by T1 is equal to what? V2 by T2. Here one thing is important. What is it? The temperature must be on the which scale? Kelvin scale or the absolute scale. The temperature must be on the Kelvin scale or the absolute scale. If temperature is given in Celsius scale, means generally we will use a small t for representing temperature on the Celsius scale. So we have to do what? How do you convert the Celsius temperature into Kelvin temperature? We have to add 273.15. How do we represent the Charles' law in terms of the graph? So since we maintain the pressure of a given amount of gas to be constant, right, these graphs are also referred as what? Isobars. Why? Because the pressure is maintained constant. So what is the thing about the Charles' law? Volume is proportional to absolute temperature. So here you see, you can write it like what? Volume is equal to some constant into absolute temperature. This is like Y is equal to M into X, straight line passing through horizon. But the thing is, no gas will be able to reach up to 0 Kelvin. This is what? 0 Kelvin, right? We cannot have a gas reaching up to 0 Kelvin. So somewhere the graph will actually stop. So we have to extrapolate. Why? Because no gas will exist until we reach 0 Kelvin. So if you try to see the same graph on the temperature taken as the Celsius value, right? Look at this, where this straight line will touch the x-axis at minus 273, or we can say minus 273.15 degrees Celsius, because that is the absolute zero on Kelvin scale, right? At that temperature, the volume is going to become what? Zero. Okay, so this is on the Kelvin scale temperature, this is on the Celsius scale temperature. This is what the Charles law representation graphical. The other law, Gay-Lussac's law, this is also called as a pressure temperature law or temperature pressure law. What is it? The pressure of a given mass of a gas. So here also, see all these things, right? We are keeping the number of moles to be fixed. Okay. If you take the volume to be constant, the pressure of that given mass of gas is directly proportional to absolute temperature. Just like, you know, the Charles' law. There, V proportional temperature, here, pressure proportional temperature. The thing is, number of moles and volume must be constant. Look at this. If you just bring it to the left side, means we can have what? P by T is constant. So if you have state 1 and state 2, right? What is it? P1 by T1 must be equal to what? P2 by T2. Okay. So the thing is, we don't have to remember all these relations for each and every law separately. Why? Because all these laws, right, will be culminating, or we can say they'll be merging into the ideal gas equation. So if you take ideal gas equation, using that we can sort of derive or take out each of these gas law equations. I'll show you how we'll do it. Okay, but tell me, what will be the graphical representation? If you look at the graphical representation, right, if you take the temperature and Kelvin scale, means it will be like what? A straight line passing through horizon, but you know, the gas will stop the existence below some temperature. So below some temperature, we have to do what? Same, extrapolate. Okay, so the graphs will be analogous to what we have in the Charles' law. Okay, because the relation is what? There we have volume proportional temperature, here we have pressure proportional to temperature. Okay, so this is about the Gay-Lussac's law, which is also called as what? Temperature pressure law. Now the fourth law is Avogadro's law. So what is it? At fixed temperature and pressure, means if you keep the temperature and pressure to be constant, right, then volume of the gas is directly proportional to the amount of the gas. Means what? Amount of the gas will represent by number of moles, right, which means what? Volume is proportional to number of moles. Volume will be proportional to, like say if you have 2 moles of gas, then you know the volume will be what? Twice that of volume of 1 mole of gas, because volume is simply proportional to what? Number of moles. Okay, so in some textbooks you might see it like volume of the gas is directly proportional to the number of moles also. Here we are saying amount of the gas, means we are representing amount of the gas in terms of what? Number of moles. Okay, so if you look at the gases, right, there is a lot of importance that we associate with this one mole. Okay, so if you take the volume occupied by one mole of any gas under the temperature and pressure conditions, whatever the given temperature and pressure conditions, if you measure what is the volume occupied by one mole of the gas, that is what we will refer to as what? Molar volume. Okay, so we'll see that at STP conditions, right, as per the old convention, I mean, you know, this is something that you will associate a lot in chemistry part. The molar volume of any gas at STP will be 22.4 liters, and the new conventions, right, the molar volume of the gas at STP, any gas, will be approximately 22.7 liters. Now the culmination of all these gas laws, right, as I said, is the ideal gas equation. So why are we calling it as ideal gas? We'll talk about it. The normal gases or the real gases like oxygen gas, hydrogen gas, nitrogen gas that we normally see, they may not satisfy this equation under all conditions. Okay, they might show some approximate behavior like this at some particular conditions of temperature and pressure, but under all conditions of temperature and pressure, they are not going to exactly satisfy this relation. That is the reason why we call it as what? Ideal gas. But while we know that the real gases won't satisfy that, for most of the times when you're solving problems, right, we'll go with the ideal gas equation itself. But we'll discuss, like, you know, for the real gases, right, we are going to do some modification for the equation, and that is what we'll be referring to as the real gas equation. So we'll talk about the real gas equation and how the real gas equation will be used for the study of the real gases. Okay, but before we go there, right, let us just talk about the ideal gas equation here. So as I said, right, look at this. What is it? Pressure into volume is equal to nRT. Now we will see how this is going to incorporate the Boyle's law. What is Boyle's law concept? for a given amount of gas means number of moles fixed. If we maintain the temperature constant, look at this. What is on the RHS side? Number of moles constant. R is what we will call as the gas constant or universal gas constant. Okay, which is a constant. T is temperature, we are going to maintain it to be constant. Look at this. The entire RHS is now becoming what? It is becoming a constant, which means the product of pressure into volume will be a constant. That is what is our Boyle's law, right? What is the Boyle's law statement? For a given amount of gas at constant temperature, the pressure is inversely proportional to volume, or volume is inversely proportional to pressure, or the product of pressure into volume will be constant. That is what we will see. Like that, you know, we can see all the gas laws can be sort of, you know, derived. Instead of using the word derived, we can say they can be obtained from the ideal gas equation. That is the reason why we call it as what? The culmination of all the gas laws. So henceforth, right, we don't need to break our head on the gas laws. We can just go with the equation and apply it in each and every case. The thing is, when you're using this equation, right, the units of R are important, because we are dealing with the pressure and volume. We know that, you know, the SI unit of pressure is Pascal, and the SI unit of volume is meter cube. But we also have some common units of pressure like atm, bar. The common unit of the volume is what? Liters. So we can have various values of R depending upon the choice of units. Like, look at this. What is the value of R in terms of the SI unit? 8.314 joule per mole per Kelvin. What is the value of R in terms of liter and atmospheres? Because if pressure is in atm and volume is in liter, right, we will go with this value of R. What is it? 0.0821 liter into atmosphere per mole per Kelvin. Then, you know, if we have the pressure given in bar, volume in liters, then look at this. What is the value of R? It is 0.083 liter bar per mole per Kelvin. What is the value of R in terms of calorie? This is something that we will be using in calorimetry and the initial part of thermodynamics. The value of R in terms of calories, what is it? Approximately 2 calorie per mole per Kelvin. Okay, so this is about the values of R, and we have to appropriately choose which value of R we will go with depending upon the units of the other quantities. Like, nowadays we may not expect like direct questions in JE and all where we have to use the ideal gas equation, but we never know. I mean, you know, you can even sometimes be given questions, some slight modification. Okay, but this ideal gas equation is something that has been beaten to death. Like, there was questions, I mean, you know, very frequently in the past. That's the reason why we'll have to see, I mean, what kind of modification they can talk about. Now, gas constant R that we talked about, right, is also called as the molar gas constant, because look at this, we are talking in terms of per mole. Here, we will also be using one more gas constant that is called as the gas constant per molecule. What is it? The gas constant per molecule, which is also known as what? Boltzmann constant, K. Either we will use K, or we can also put this K subscript B like that. Okay, because, you know, K is something that we've used quite often, even in like heat transfer also. We have used this as a spring constant, K. Then we have used this for the thermal conductivity, and even in plus 2 topic when we go to the Coulomb's law, right, there we will use K as the symbol for the Coulomb's constant also. Okay, that is the reason why if you want to differentiate means, you can go with this K subscript B like that. What is this? This is what we will refer to as the Boltzmann constant. What is it? If you look at it, right, pressure into volume is equal to number of moles into R into T. If you have one mole, means what is it? Pressure into volume is equal to R into T. This is for what? One mole. What about for one molecule? What is the ideal gas equation for one molecule? Look at this. If you have only one molecule, right, what is the number of moles means? Number of moles will be what? Given number of particles by Avogadro number, right? So 1 by Avogadro number into RT will come. So look at this. This is what? PV is equal to R by NA. NA means, you know, award number. So this is R by NA, right? This is what we are referring as what? The Boltzmann constant. Look at this. If you take the value of R as 8.314 and substitute the value of award number, right? Then we'll get the Boltzmann constant to be what? 1.38. I mean, we don't need to remember this value as it is, but look at this. What is it? 1.38 in 10 power minus 23 joule per Kelvin. This is what? The gas constant per molecule. Okay. So the gas equation per molecule can be written as what? Pressure into volume is equal to KB into temperature. This is what we'll refer as the gas equation per molecule. Now, the other macro behavior, what is it? The mixture of gases, how they will exert the pressure or how they will behave. How they behave means we are talking in terms of how much pressure they will exert, because behavior means what? We'll talk about studying one of the properties, right? So if you look at the Dalton's law of partial pressures, it is based on the concept or the idea of the partial pressure. So we'll talk about what it is. Okay. So what is the basic statement? Look at this. The total pressure exerted by the mixture of gases is equal to what? Sum of the partial pressure of the each gas. Like, look at this. This is the gas container in which we have gas A and gas B. Number of moles NA, number of moles NB. So here the total pressure of that mixture, the pressure exerted by the mixture, right, will be equal to sum of the partial pressures of each gas. What do you mean by partial pressure? Let us say the volume of the container is V. We are maintaining at the temperature T. The partial pressure concept is, if you assume that the entire volume V is occupied by only the gas A, then look at this from the ideal gas equation, right? What is the pressure that gas A will create? Number of moles, because what is the ideal gas equation? P is equal to nRT by V, right? Look at this. What is the pressure that gas A will create? Number of moles of gas A into RT by volume. So here we have to take that gas A is occupying the entire volume of the container. This is what we will refer to as the partial pressure. Means, in the container, yes, we have gas A as well as gas B. So, but we have to assume what? There is no gas B, just gas A is there. Then whatever the pressure that the gas A will exert, if we assume that the other gas are not there, right, only this is there, that pressure is what we will refer to as what? Partial pressure of the gas A. Same way for the gas B also. Look at this. Number of moles of gas B into RT by the total volume of the container. This is what is the, what is this? The partial pressure of the gas B. So what is the Dalton's law saying? Total pressure is equal to what? Partial pressure of gas A plus partial pressure of gas B. So from here, right, in chemistry, you will do even a couple of more steps. And then you will conclude what? For any gas, the partial pressure is equal to total pressure into mole fraction of the gas, like that. Okay. So PB will be equal to what? P total into mole fraction of gas B. So those kind of results are not required that much in here for us, because our idea is not Dalton's law study. Our idea is what? The study of the kinetic theory of gases. The next macro behavior is the diffusion law, which is what also called as the Gram's law of diffusion. So we have two phenomena kind of identical shown by the gases. One is called as diffusion, second is effusion. Okay, what is it? The ability of a gas to spread and occupy the whole of the available volume irrespective of the other gases present in the container. That is what we call as a diffusion phenomena. Like, you think of it, right? You have a room. There is a room. In one corner, you just break one gas cylinder. I mean, that is not advisable, but like, you know, even if they say, for example, the LPG cylinder is leaking in one corner, like corner of the kitchen. Sitting in the living room, we can smell it. Why? Because of the diffusion. The gas is able to, yes, in the entire room, the other gases are there, oxygen, nitrogen, but the leaked LPG, right, is able to come and occupy the entire available volume, irrespective of the presence of the other gases. This is what we will refer to as diffusion. Okay. The other phenomenon is effusion. What is it? It is the process by which a gas will escape from one chamber of vessel through a small opening or orifice. Like, think of it, right? You have a, a chamber of a gas where we just, you know, like a cylinder type or a vessel. You just keep a small opening. Okay, wow. So if you keep a small opening or some hole, you will see that the gas will escape through that small opening. Okay, and this behavior rate is again going to be only depending upon the property of that gas alone, which means if you look at the law rate that governs the rate of diffusion or rate of effusion. Okay, so the rate of diffusion means that we can measure it in terms of how much volume of the gas is like coming out of that hole in a given time. Like that we can define the rate of effusion. Okay, so if you look at the rate, that is directly proportional to pressure, means here it is not the total pressure, it is the partial pressure of the gas. Like in cylinder we have nitrogen gas and oxygen gas. When you are trying to look at the rate of effusion of nitrogen, we have to talk about what? The partial pressure of nitrogen. When talking about the rate for the oxygen, we have to talk about what? The partial pressure of the oxygen. And the rate is proportional to 1 by root m, or we can say it is what? Inversely proportional to, what is it? It is inversely proportional to square root of molar mass. So molar mass represents what? Inertia. More molar mass means what? More inertia. The particles cannot move that much speed. So we can see that the relation is what? Inverse. But it is not just inverse, it is what? Inversely proportional to square root of the molar mass. And these two are when we are keeping the temperature to be constant. So if you merge them, right, then what we will get? The rate proportional to what? P by root m. So if you compare two gases rate, R1 by R2, if you compare two gases at same temperature, then R1 by R2 will be equal to what? P1 by P2 into root of M2 by M1, because the M is in the denominator, root M is in the denominator. Okay, so this is the relation we can have to compare the rates of diffusion or effusion of two gases. Here one thing we have to keep in mind, when we say pressure, right, what is the pressure that we are referring to? It is the partial pressure of the gas. It is the partial pressure of the respective gases. Okay. Now we will come to the crux of the chapter, because we have seen the macro behavior. To explain the macro behavior, we have these set of assumptions. That is what we are referring as what? The assumptions of the kinetic theory of gases. So what are these assumptions of the kinetic theory of gases? If you look at the basic assumptions, right, it says every gas is composed of tiny particles. What do we call them as? Like, you know, from the knowledge of chemistry, you know that they will be what? Molecules. The size of the molecules is much smaller than the intermolecular spacing. Means if you take the container, right, the size of the actual size of the molecules is very small in comparison to the actual intermolecular spacing, which means what? We can say the volume occupied by the gas molecules is negligible in comparison to the volume of container. The volume occupied by the gas molecules, the real volume occupied by the gas molecules is what? Negligible in comparison to the volume of the container. Okay. And the molecules of a gas, if you take the molecules of a gas, means they will be identical. Okay. And they will be spherical, they will be rigid, and also they will be what? Having elastic behavior. So elastic behavior in a sense, because again, why are we calling them as point masses? Because we are neglecting the actual volume occupied by them. So the elastic behavior is associated with the kind of collisions they will have between themselves and also with the walls of the container. The collisions, right, because the molecules will be in constant motion, rapid motion. So the molecules will be in a state of random rapid motion. In the rapid motion, right, they will collide with each other as well as with the walls of the container. Like you see one molecule, right, it is going to have let's say first collision here, then its velocity will change. It will have second collision here, then its velocity will change. Like, you know, if you look at the overall motion, it will be what? Random motion. But between two collisions, if you see, it is going to move in a straight line with a constant velocity. This is another important point. Sometimes, you know, we may get questions straight on the assumptions of the kinetic gas theory. Between two collisions, right? The gas molecules are going to go with constant velocity in a straight line. But overall motion, if you see, it will be what? Like a zigzag path, random path. But the collisions, right? Whether we talk about collisions between the gas particles or collisions with the walls of the container, all the collisions are what? Perfectly elastic in terms of nature. So there will be no overall energy loss during collision. The energy might be transmitted from one particle to another particle, but overall energy loss is not going to be there. That is the reason why we will see that the gas particles, after some time, they will not stop. If the elastic collisions are not there, if the collisions are inelastic, then what is going to happen? Each and every collision happening means the gas particles will lose energy, right? So eventually they have to stop at some time. But that is not happening, right? The gas molecules will not settle down after some time. They keep on having the random motion. And that is possible because the collisions are elastic. Now, if you look at the time spent in collision between two molecules, that will be negligible in comparison to the time between two successive collisions. Actually, the time between two successive collisions, right, means, look at this. A molecule is having one collision here. Okay, so collision one is happening here. Then it is going to go and then have the collision two. The time between two successive collisions, right? If you take and because that will keep changing. The time between two successive collisions, it will keep changing. Between first collision to second collision, we will have a different time. Second collision to third collision, we may have a different time. If you take the average of all these, right, that is what we call as generally the relaxation time. The average of time between two successive collisions is called as what? Relaxation time. And the actual time of collision means when the two particles are actually colliding, right? Because in the collisions we have talked about, what happens during elastic collision? There will be a momentary compression of particles, then there will be bounce back. The time or the duration of collision is negligible in comparison to the relaxation time. That is another assumption, okay? And the number of collisions per unit volume, this is what we will also refer to as the collision frequency. It will be remaining constant at a given temperature. Means if the temperature is increasing, means what? The gas velocities are going to increase. So there will be more number of collisions, means the collision frequency is going to increase. Okay. So if you fix the temperature, means the collision frequency or the number of collisions per unit volume will be remaining the same. And the other assumption is, this is also an important one, we will assume that there are no attractive or repulsive forces between the gas molecules. So between the gas molecules, there are neither attractive forces nor repulsive forces. But what we are going to see is, when we talk about the real gases, like when the real gas molecules are very far away, then they will attract each other. That is because of electron cloud of one molecule attracted by the nucleus of the other molecule, and so on. These interactions, we may look at them like in chemistry language, right? You will call them as Van der Waals interactions, dipole-dipole interactions, and all these things. But same time, when we bring the two particles very, very close, then the electrons of this molecule and electrons of the molecule, they will start repelling, because when they come so close, they will start repelling. Means when the molecules are very far away, they will be having attractive forces. This is what happens with the real gases. When the molecules are too compressed, then they will have repulsive forces. So while in the case of the assumptions of the kinetic gas theory, that is the reason why we will say kinetic gas theory is going to explain the behavior of the ideal gas. So we are saying that there will be no attractive or no repulsive forces between the gas molecules. But in case of the real gases, then the volume is very large, which means what? The molecules are very, very far away. Volume large means pressure less. At low pressures, right, generally what? The particles will be very far away, so we'll have attractive forces. At high pressures means, you know, we compress the gas. Then what do we see? The molecules will start repelling because they have come very, very close. That is going to be the case of the real gases. We'll talk about it. Okay. So these are the assumptions of the kinetic gas theory. And from these assumptions, we have the results. Okay. Now, talking in terms of the results of the kinetic theory of gases, right? We have prominently we'll talk about two results. One is the result of the mean free path, and other is the result where we'll have the kinetic gas equation that will explain the pressure created by a gas on the walls of the container. So here, if you look at it, right? So previously we talked about the relaxation time between two successive collisions. The average value of the time that the particle will spend is called as what? Relaxation time. Similarly, the average distance traveled by the molecule between two successive collisions, that is called as what? Mean free path. If you look at the dependency rate, what is the dependency? It will be kT by root 2 pi sigma square into P. Here, sigma is the diameter of the molecule, P is the pressure of the gas, and T is the temperature, K is the Boltzmann constant. So here we can see from this relation, lambda is directly proportional to temperature, means if you increase the temperature, means what? The mean free path will be increasing. Lambda will be proportional to 1 by P, means what? If you increase pressure, means lambda will be what? Decreasing. You can see the relation also, it will be decreasing graph. We have one more alternative form for that, this mean free path formula, right? That is lambda will be 1 by root 2 pi sigma square into N. So here this N is number density of gas molecules, means number of gas molecules per unit volume. How this comes? Look at this. Now, from the ideal gas equation, PV is equal to nRT. Don't confuse between this and this. This is the number of moles. PV is equal to number of moles, means what? The actual number of molecules by Avogadro number into RT. Okay, so here R by Avogadro number is Boltzmann constant. So look at this, PV is equal to the actual number of molecules into Boltzmann constant into T. So here you can see the P by KT, right? P by KT will be what? So from here, P by KT will be N by V, number of molecules per volume. That is what is the number density. Okay, so P by KT is what? So here you can look at it, now the KT can come to the denominator, right? P by KT. What is P by KT? Number density. So like this, we'll have the alternative form. What is it? Lambda will be equal to 1 by root 2 pi sigma square into N. N is the number density of the gas molecules, number of gas molecules per unit volume. The first one is to see how the lambda is dependent upon temperature and pressure. Similarly, the other result is the pressure exerted by the gas. Here, in fact, we have a derivation itself. But now we will not go through the derivation, we will just look at the final result. So if we look at the gas molecules collisions with the walls of the container, they will undergo change in velocity. Means there is a change in momentum. So for the gas molecules, there is a change in momentum. So change in momentum means the rate of change of momentum will be representing what? The force acting on the gas molecules. So as per the Newton's third law, right, if there is a force acting on the gas molecules, there will be an equal and opposite force acting on the walls of the container as per the Newton's third law. If you look at what is that force that is created by all the molecules, right, so we can see what the total force that we can add up, and we can call it as what? Thrust divided by the area. So thrust divided by area will give us what? The pressure, right? Thrust divided by the area will give us what? The pressure. So that way we will be able to see that the pressure acting on the walls of the container will be related to the change in momentum, means it will be related to what? The velocities of gas molecules. How it is related? That is what we have in the kinetic gas equation. What is it? PV is equal to 1 by 3 mn c square, or this is also called as what? Vrms the square. Here P is the pressure, V is the volume, m is a mass of each gas particle, small m, n, capital N, is a number of particles, Vrms is what we will call as the RMS velocity of the gas. What is RMS velocity of the gas? We are going to see. We will see, you know, what is the definition of RMS velocity of the gas, how do we use it, all that we will discuss when we talk about the gas velocities. But this is, you know, the result in terms of the pressure. So we can see how the velocity of the gas particles, that is relative momentum, is going to impact in terms of the pressure acting on the walls of the container. So this is also what we call as the ideal a gas equation that will come from the kinetic gas theory. Okay, so also we will refer to as what the kinetic gas equation, like that we will refer to it. Okay, so we are not going through the derivation. Actually, we will, in the detailed video, right, we will cover the derivation about how the PV is equal to 1 by 3 mn vrms square will come. Now, as we discussed about the RMS velocity, we said that is one velocity term that we can define for the gas system, right? If you generally try to understand, if you take a single gas molecule, its velocity keeps on changing. After every collision, the velocity keeps on changing. Even if you look at it one instant of time, it is not like all the gas particles are going to have the same velocity. They will have different velocities. At a given temperature, if you look at the distribution of the velocity of the gases, you can see here, if you mark what is the fraction of molecules having a particular velocity, you plot it as a graph. That is what we call as the velocity distribution graph. The Maxwell is even given the theoretical equations for that. What we will see is that the molecular velocities, right, will have a set pattern at a given temperature. Means what? Here you can see maybe some 0.2 fraction of the entire molecules available, they are having a particular value of velocity. In the next instant of time, as we said, molecules keep changing the velocities, but if some molecules are going to change the velocity from this, whatever the value, let's say this is some 250 meter per second, some 0.2 of the overall fraction of particles are having 250 meter per second velocity. In the next moment, some of these particles, they will change the velocities. Other particles, they will come to the 250 meter per second, so that this fraction of molecules that contain 250 meter per second will always going to remain what, 0.2. like that, the pattern is going to remain same at a given temperature. If you increase temperature, means all the velocities will increase, all the particles velocities will be increasing, that we will see. And here in the graph, right, we are talking about these three velocity terms. Look at this, this is not AVS, this is what, average. So we're talking about VMP, most probable, then V average, average velocity, then VRMS, RMS. So what is this graph about? This is about DNU, the total number of molecules which are in the velocity range U to U plus DU, that distribution velocity. This is the number of total molecules are there. If you divide DNU by total number, N means N is the total number of molecules in that collection. That will be the fraction, what fraction of molecules are having the particular velocity. You can see the formula, right? We don't have to remember the formula as it is, but what is it? 4 pi into capital M. What is capital M? The molar mass of the gas. Here we can go with everything in the SI system. By 2 pi RT whole power 3 by 2 U square into E power minus MU square by 2 RT into DU. So here the R is the gas constant, U is that the starting level velocity, and DU is what, the differential spread in the velocity. In that differential spread, we are calculating what fraction of molecules are present. T is obviously the temperature, and which should be on the Kelvin scale. Okay, so here the idea is not to remember this Maxwell's equation, but to understand the pattern. Now if you look at this pattern, right, there are some clear inferences. Again, here also, this is what, average. Molecules will have different speeds due to collisions. Obviously, why different molecules are having different speeds means they'll have, because of the collisions, each molecule velocity keeps on changing over a period of time. Only a small fraction of the total molecules have either very high or very low velocity. Look at this, very high range, small fraction, very low, small fraction. In fact, none of the molecules will have zero velocity because they'll keep on moving. And you see here, right, the peak, the Maxwell's distribution graph is reaching the peak. That is what we will be referring as what, the most probable velocity. What is it? It is the velocity possessed by maximum fraction of particles. And from the graph, you can see one thing. What is it? VRMS value is more than the V average is more than what most probable. Most probable will have the least value. We'll see. Once we cover the definitions of these velocity terms, we will talk about what are the expressions for these velocity terms. From that also, we will be able to see this result that most probable value will be least. Then comes average, then comes the RMS. Okay. As we said, right, all these velocities, whether we talk about the most probable velocity term or the average or the RMS, all of them will be increasing with temperature. Because if increase temperature means what? The energy of the thermal energy of the gas particles will increase, which means they will start moving with higher speeds. Now we will begin our discussion with the root mean square speed. So root mean square speed is basically what, I mean, from the name itself, right, root mean of the squared velocities. Root, we are taking a mean. If n is the total number of particles, mean for what? Squared velocities, v1 square plus v2 square. What is this? If you do v1 square plus v2 square plus v3 square divided by n means, what is it? It is the mean value of the squared velocities. You take a root of it. That is what is the root mean square velocity, RMS, VRMS. And now we have the derivation also for this. We will see. What is it? This is a root 3 RT by capital M, where capital M is the molar mass. Look at this, you know, 3. R is what? K into Avogadro number. Molar mass is what? Mass of each particle into Avogadro number. So Avogadro number can cancel. So root 3 KT by small m, where small m is gas of each particle, K is the Boltzmann constant. RT by M, right, from the ideal gas equation, what is it? PV is equal to number of moles, mass of gas by molar mass into RT. So look at this, PV by mass of gas, right, that is what? RT by molar mass. So in place of RT by M, what we can keep? PV by mass of gas. Okay, similarly, you look at this, one more alternative form. So all these are alternative form for the RMS velocity. Now we'll see that, you know, all the velocity terms, right, they'll have almost similar relation. The RMS velocity and most probable, all of them will have almost similar kind of expressions will be there. So look at this, we have mass of gas by volume, what is it? Density. So in this formula, root 3p by mass of the gas divided by volume, like that we can bring the volume to the denominator. So what is mass by volume means? Density, root 3p by rho. So this is what? Density. So these are the alternative formulas for the RMS. Now we'll see how this RMS velocity will be derived. In fact, it can be derived from the kinetic gas equation. So we'll see how we'll derive it. So what is the kinetic gas equation? PV is equal to 1 by 3 mn vrms the square. So PV is equal to 1 by 3, m is mass of each particle, n is the number of particles. What is it? The total mass of the gas. So PV is what? nRT is equal to 1 by 3 mass of the gas into VRMS the square. So what is N means? Number of moles is what? Mass of gas by molar mass into RT is equal to what? 1 by 3 into mass of gas into VRMS the square. So mass of gas will be cancelled. Bring the 3 to the left side, it will go to the numerator. What is it? 3 RT by molar mass is equal to what? VRMS the square, which means what? Root 3 RT by molar mass is equal to VRMS. This is what is the expression we have seen, right? Now the other velocity is the most probable velocity, which is VMP. So we'll see the results of the most probable velocity that has come from the Maxwell's distribution. What is it? You look at the formula, what is it? Root 2 RT by M. Alternative formula is what? Root 2 KT by small m. Small m is mass of each molecule or the particle. Another alternative form is what? Root 3 2p by rho. Okay. Similarly, the average speed. What is average speed? The arithmetic mean of all the speeds of the molecules. What is it? V1 plus V2 plus V3 and so on divided by L. We cannot calculate it like this. But what is the formula? Root 8 RT by pi m. Alternatively, we can say what? Root 8 KT by pi into small m. Small m is mass of each molecule. Otherwise, we have it as what? Root 8 P by pi into rho. So, if you look at these velocities, right? V most probable is to V average, V is to V RMS. Root 2 RT by m, root 8 RT by pi m, root 3 RT by m. So, root RT by m, we can cancel it off in all the. So, what is the ratio? Root 2 is to root of 8 by pi is to root 3. Pi is what? 22 by 7, right? If you substitute, means root 2 is to root of 56 by 22 is to root 3. This, if we simplify, right, what we'll get? What is the ratio? 1 is to 1.128 is to 1.224. In fact, this ratio, right, in fact, has come as one of the questions in JEE mains, I think 2013. So, JEE mains, we got a question as it is. What is the ratio of the most probable velocity to the average to the RMS? What is the ratio? 1 is to 1.128 is to 1.224. Using this, right, we can convert the velocities. Like if you have the most probable value given, in the ratio, we can find average value, we can find RMS value like that. Okay. So, this is about the gas velocities. And one thing you can see clearly see here, what is it? Any velocity term that you take is directly proportional to root of temperature. Means, if you increase temperature, means the velocity term also is going to be increasing. So, this is about the gas velocities. Now, when the gas particles are having velocities, means obviously they are having energy, right? For the ideal gases, which we consider like point particles, we will talk about the velocity that will be there for the particles because of just the translation motion part. And that is what we will be referring as what? The internal energy of the gas. So, for the ideal gas means we will take them as like what? Point masses, right? The internal energy will be only because of what? It is only because of the translation motion. So, how do we see this? Look at it now. So, what is the relation we have from the kinetic gas equation? PV is equal to 1 by 3 mn V RMS the square. What is it? M 1 by 3 mn. What is V RMS square means? V1 square plus V2 square divided by n. Nn gets cancelled. 1 by 3 m into V1 square m into V2 square. So, if you multiply, this is what? PV. If you multiply half on both sides, PV by 2 is equal to what? Right side, we will take the 2 in half inside the bracket. Half m V1 square, half m V2 square, like that. So, both sides we are divided by 2, but we have taken the 2 inside the bracket. So, if you add up all these half m1 V1 square plus half, because all the particles will have same mass, right? That's why we have m. Half m v1 square plus half m v2 square. What is all this? We are adding the kinetic energy, translation kinetic energy of all the particles. That is the total, what is it? The internal energy. So, bring the 3 to the left side. 3 pv by 2. What is it? The total internal energy of the gas. From the ideal gas equation, right, in place of PV, what we can write? nRT. So, 3 by 2 nRT. This is what? The total internal energy of the gas. This is for the ideal gas, where we consider the gas to be like what? Point masses, where the kinetic energy will be the only internal energy. The translation kinetic energy will be the only internal energy for the gas. Now, here is for the gas which is n moles. If you take 1 mole of the gas, this is for n moles, right? If you take 1 mole of the gas, then for that we have to put n is equal to 1, right? So, what is the internal energy? 3 by 2 RT. This is for 1 mole. For one particle means we have to divide this with what? Avogadro number, right? So, what is it? 3 by 2 RT divided by what? Avogadro number. So here what is R by Avogadro number? Boltzmann constant. What is it? 3 by 2 KT. If you take one ideal gas particle, there is like a point mass. What is the translation kinetic energy for that? 3 by 2 KT. Now using this rate, there is a theory which is what is called as the principle of equipartition of energy. What is it? As we see the translation motion, right? Translation motion means we'll associate the motion in three independent directions, which is the, like we can say, motion along x-axis, motion along y, motion along z. Each of these independent directions of motion, we will be calling it as a degree of freedom, which will be independent. Like as per the law of equipartition of energy, for any system, right, which is in thermal equilibrium, the total energy will be equally distributed among the various degrees of freedom. And each degree of freedom, right, will be associated with how much energy? Half KT, where K is the Boltzmann constant, T is the temperature on absolute scale. How this comes? Look at this now. Just now only what we said, the total translation kinetic energy for the molecule, single molecule, is 3 by 2 KT. This is coming because of what? Translation motion along x-axis, translation motion along y-axis, translation motion along z-axis. So means what? For 3 degrees of freedom, what is the energy? 3 by 2 KT. So 3, 3 gets cancelled. For 1 degree of freedom, right, what is the energy that will have? Half KT. So this is what we will refer to as the principle of equipartition of energy. Now using this, right, we will see how we will calculate the total internal energy of a gas. But before that, we should understand about the concept of degrees of freedom. As we said, right, if you take a ideal gas, which is the monatomic gas, we will take the gas to be like what? Single particle. We will only have 3 degrees of freedom, which is the translation. What is it? We will have 3 translational degrees of freedom. That's it. So we will represent the degrees of freedom with the symbol F. F is equal to 3. If it is a diatomic, means what? We have 2 atoms in the molecule. Diatomic molecule, right? So we'll have a bonding between them. A diatomic molecule, observe this carefully, will have as it is. So 3 translation will come for all of them. There will be what? 3 translational degrees of freedom, x-axis, y-axis, z-axis. Apart from that, look at this. If you take, like, this is the x, this is the y, and the internuclear axis as what? Z-axis. We will see that the molecule can rotate with respect to x-axis. It will have a considerable moment of inertia, which means that will be having what? A rotational kinetic energy. Similarly, it can rotate with respect to y-axis and have considerable moment of inertia. Means the degree of freedom will be there for the rotational energy also with respect to y-axis. But what about the z-axis? This is the axis on which the molecules are lying, or like the atoms of the molecule are lying, which means what? The iz value will be negligible. This is something that we will study in our rotational motion, right? When the particles are on the axis, moment of inertia will be zero. Okay, so since they are lying on the z-axis, right, the moment of inertia will be what? Negligible. So in addition to the 2 translation, we will get, in addition to the 3 translation, right, we will get 2 rotational degrees of freedom. So totally what is it? F will be equal to 5. Understand this carefully. Why we are neglecting the rotational kinetic energy with respect to z-axis means that is the internuclear axis. So only the ix and iy parts will be significant. Now when we go to the triatomic or polyatomic, linear means like CO2. Linear means what? They are along the same line. Again, same story comes. We take the z-axis as the internuclear axis. So iz will be what? It will be not considerable. As a result of it, what we'll have? 3 translation plus 2 rotation. What is it? The F value will be equal to 5. Same as diatomic. But if it is a triatomic or polyatomic non-linear, then what happens? Look at this. The molecule is what? Non-linear, like ozone. Here you think about it. You say this is X. You say this is Y. You take any axis, Z axis. We will not see all the atoms of the molecule lying on the same line, which means here we are going to be having what? 3 translational plus 3 rotational. So totally what is the F value? F will be equal to what? 6. That is for the triatomic or polyatomic non-linear. So here the IZ will not be insignificant. It will be what? Considerable. So we will have rotational degree of freedom with respect to the Z-axis also. Okay, because here we will not see all the atoms lying on the same line. So F value will be equal to what? 5. Now, for one molecule, right? If you take one molecule, what is the total internal energy? If you represent this with a symbol E, what is it for one molecule? Number of degrees of freedom F means it will be what? F into half KT. For one mole means what? We have to multiply this with what? Avogadro number. What is K into Avogadro number? That is the gas constant R. So for one mole, what is it? F by 2 into RT. For n number of moles, means simply we have to multiply with what? F, right? So what is it? N into F by 2 RT. For n number of moles, what is it? N into F by 2 RT. This is the internal energy of the gas, total internal energy. Okay, so here based upon monatomic mass, F is equal to what? 3. Diatomic means F is equal to what? 5. Triatomic or polyatomic linear means same, F is equal to 5. Triatomic or polyatomic non-linear means F is equal to what? 6. Like that, based on the F value, the internal energy also will be keep on changing. Now in this raid, we are still dealing with no interactions between the particles. That is why we have not considered the potential energy part. So look at this. If you talk about the correlation between the kinetic theory of gases and the thermal properties of matter, right? Thermal properties of matter, we'll talk about the molar specific heat capacity of the gases. We'll see here how they will depend upon the temperature. Look at this. If you have a temperature T, what is the internal energy? The total internal energy is what? F by 2 nRT. Change means what? Here everything is fixed, only temperature has to change. F by 2 n or delta T, that is the change in internal energy. We will see in thermodynamics, right? Change in internal energy will be equal to nCV delta T. This derivation we will do in the thermodynamics video. Equate both of them. F by 2 n or delta T is equal to nCV delta T. So nn gets cancelled. What is CV value? F R by 2. If CV is F R by 2, what is CP? This relation also we are going to see. CP is equal to what? CV plus R. Okay, CP is equal to CV plus R means what? F by 2 R plus R. What is it? If you take R common out, means F by 2 plus 1 into R. If you want to find what is the Poisson ratio, gamma, CP by CV for a gas, right? What is it? CP is what? F by 2 plus 1 into R divided by CV is what? F by 2 R. So RR gets cancelled. Then if you take an LCM, means what is it? Numerator is F plus 2 by 2. Denominator is what? F by 2. 2 gets cancelled. What is it? F plus 2 by F. Okay, so if you split it, means what is it? 1 plus 2 by F will come. That is what is the Poisson ratio value gamma in terms of degree of freedom. So depending upon the degree of freedom, right? In fact, we can look at this formula, this relation. Gamma is equal to what? 1 plus 2 by F. Sometimes we may expect questions straight on this relation itself. Okay, but remember one thing in mind. These two relations, right? What are the two relations? Delta U formula, nCV delta T. CV is what? Molar specific heat capacity at constant volume. CP is what? Molar specific heat capacity at constant pressure. This one, this formula. And the Mayer's equation. What is the Mayer's equation? CP is equal to CV plus R. That relation also, we will see the derivation in the thermodynamics part. Okay. Now to summarize the molar specific heat capacities of different types of gases, right? If you have a monatomic gas, where the degree of freedom will be, number of degrees of freedom will be 3. The internal energy of the gas formula will be, for the 1 mole of the gas, it will be F by 2 RT. So, where F will be equal to 3. So, it will be 3 by 2 RT. For a diatomic or polyatomic, poly means, 3 onwards. Linear means, you will have it as F is 5. So, it will be 5 by 2 RT. Polyatomic non-linear means, it will be F is 6. So, 6 by 2 RT means, it will be 3 RT. Similarly, the CV value, it will be F by 2 into R. So, for the monatomic, 3 by 2 R. Diatomic or polyatomic linear means 5 by 2 R. Polyatomic non-linear means it will be 3 R. CP value from the Mayer's formula, right? CP is equal to CV plus R. This is only for the gases. In fact, CP and CV, this differentiation rate will only come in the case of gases. For the liquids and solids, the specific heat capacities will not depend upon the manner in which we will do the process. Whether we are performing it under constant pressure or constant volume, that will not be affecting the specific heat capacity for the solids or liquids. That is the reason why for solids and liquids, right, we don't define different types of specific heat capacities. There will be only one specific heat capacity. So, for the, of course, here we are discussing about the gases, right? For the monatomic, CP will be 5 by 2 R, it will be CV plus R. Diatomic and polyatomic linear means it will be 7 by 2 R. Non-linear means it will be what, 4 R. The ratio of CP to CV of any gas, that is what we call as the Poisson's ratio. Gamma will be 5 by 3, 1.67 monatomic. 7 by 5, 1.4 diatomic and polyatomic linear. 4 by 3, which is 1.33, that is for the polyatomic non-linear. So, we can see here the other relation, right? Gamma will be equal to 1 plus 2 by F. Like in this, right, I think we already talked about what kind of other questions that can be framed. So, they will say there is a hypothetical gas with degrees of freedom some 12 or something. They will ask what is the gamma value for the gas like that. So, this formula will help us to solve those kind of questions. Now, while we are discussing about the degree of freedom, right, what is it that we have mentioned? We talked about the translational energy part, and also we have talked about the rotation energy part. But as we know, there will be also, if you take the atoms in a molecule to be connected through a chemical bond, there will be also these vibrations, to and fro vibrations possible. The atoms can approach each other and also they can receive. So, the to and fro vibrations, right, is something that we will see even in oscillation chapter. We will talk about the energy associated with the vibrations. So, there we will say there will be two types of energies that we will mention. So, one is the kinetic energy, second is the potential energy part. Vibration, kinetic energy, vibrational, potential energy. So, we will get to know more about these energy terms when we go to the oscillation chapter. But the thing is, if you talk about every vibrational mode, so for every vibrational mode, we will associate this with what? Two energy terms. One is the vibrational kinetic energy with that mode, and second is the vibrational potential energy. So for every one vibrational mode, we are going to be having an additional 2 degrees of freedom that will come. Because each degree of freedom is going to represent energy only, right? So, one kinetic energy part, one potential energy part. So, if you say 2 vibrational modes, then there will be what? 2 plus 2, 4 degrees of freedom extra will come. But the very important thing that we need to keep in mind is, generally only when we have high temperatures, like typically 1000 Kelvin or above, that is where the vibrational mode will become significant. Otherwise, at normal temperatures, right, ordinary temperatures, the vibrational mode will not be significant. So, in most of the cases, right, they will themselves mention the question. Like they will mention the question saying, consider that there are 2 vibrational modes. Consider that there is 1 vibrational mode like that. The point is, for every 1 vibrational mode, there will be extra 2 degrees of freedom that will come. That is what we need to keep in mind. Okay. Now, we talked about the molar specific heat capacity of the gases and different conditions, CP, CV, what is the relation between them, etc. What about the specific heat capacity of the solids? Of course, we are talking about the molar specific heat capacity of the solids. Like if you look at a solid, right, we will have a 3D lattice. three dimensional arrangement of the particles of the solid. The particles of the solid will be having fixed positions, which means there will be no translation, there will be no rotational motion, but there is going to be vibration about the mean positions of the respective particles, right? There will be vibrations. So as we can see here, right, if you take a 3D lattice, means we can talk about three independent vibrational modes. One is, let's say, along x-axis, other will be y-axis, third will be along the z-axis, which means we'll have what, three vibrational modes that can be associated with the solid. Each vibrational mode, we said the degree of freedom will be 2. So, 3 vibrational modes means totally it will account for what? 3 into 2, it will be 6. So, for a solid, if you take, there will be no translation, you can see, there will be no rotational degrees of freedom, there will be only vibrational. And since we have 3 independent directions of vibration, we'll have 3 vibrational modes. Each will give additional 2 degrees of freedom. So, 3 2s are what? 6. Here, there is no additional concept. Why? Because there is no translation, there is no rotation. So, whatever the degrees of freedom, right, they are going to only come from the vibration part. So, the total degrees of freedom in that sense is what? 6. Now, CV is what? F by 2R, right? So, F is 6. So, 6 by 2R, that is what? 3R. So, as we mentioned before, in case of solids or even liquids, the specific heat capacity would not depend upon the manner in which we achieve the process. So, which means for solids, right, we will just have one specific heat capacity. There is no difference between CP and CV. There is only one thing. That is what we call as the molar specific heat capacity of the solid. So, the Mayer's formula CP is equal to CV plus R, right, that is only for the gases. In fact, in the thermodynamics chapter, when we go, we will see the derivation. That will be only for the gases. It is not for the liquids and solids. So, the point is, when we say solids, right, we will not differentiate between the CP and CV. There is only one molar specific heat capacity for the solids. What is the value of it? 3R. And that is going to come from where? You can see from this formula, the 6 degrees of freedom, that will come from 3 independent modes of vibration. But there will be no translational degrees of freedom. There will be no rotational motion degrees of freedom. Only the vibration part will be there for the solids. Because after all, the solid particles in the lattice are having fixed positions, right? Okay, so this is about the specific heat capacity of the solids. Now, what we'll do is, we talked about the gases. And you know, in our micro analysis of the gases, right, which we did using the kinetic theory of gases, we have talked about some assumptions. Like, you know, we said the intermolecular force of attraction or repulsion is not there between the gas particles. But real gases, the intermolecular attractive or repulsive forces, like when the molecules are very far away, means they will attract. When the molecules are brought very close, means what? The electron cloud of one molecule will repel the electron cloud of the other. So what happens typically? The molecules will repel. So the attractive force and repulsive forces, we cannot totally neglect for the real gas. And the other thing is, the volume of the gaseous molecules is negligible in comparison to the volume of the container. So, wherever, whichever container we are keeping the gas, we said what, the volume occupied by the gas particles is negligible in comparison to the volume of the container. I mean, from this assumption, right, what we took is, like, if you consider the volume of the cylinder like V, or the container is V, the outcome is the entire volume V is available for the free movement of the gas particles. The entire volume V is available for the free, means, you know, each and every gas molecule, right, can go to the entire volume V. That is what is the assumption. But practically what happens in case of the real gases is, the molecules themselves have volume. Like if you look at any molecule, right, in chemistry, Bohr's model, you study about how do you estimate the size of the atoms. Then, you know, size of the atom means size of the molecule also can be estimated. In chemical bonding, in chemistry, you talk about the bond length, etc. That also gives a fair idea of what is the size of molecule. But the point is, it is not just that the molecules occupy volume. Their electron cloud will also not allow other molecules to come within some surrounding region. That is what we call as the restricted volume like that. Why? Because this molecule is having electron cloud, means you know the valence electron cloud. The other molecules also will have it, so they will repel. So that is the reason why not just the actual volume taken by the molecule, but also some space around it, right, will be forbidden. It will be restricted for the free movement. So which means the entire container volume V is not available for the free movement of the gas particles. That is another difference that we have to take a note in case of the real gases. Now as such, right, the ideal gas concept is theoretical. There is no the ideal gas that we can mention about, because the thing is, ideal gases cannot be liquefied, whereas the real gases, I mean whatever the gas that we talk about, whether you talk about hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, any gas that can be liquefied, like even so called hydrogen, right? So if you take the temperature to around 20 Kelvin, this we will see in the hydrogen and its compounds, the hydrogen gas can be liquefied. So the real gases can be liquefied because they have the attractive forces between them. When gas becomes a liquid, when the attractive forces between the gas particles are able to bring the particles together and form the liquid. But the real, I mean the ideal gas concept, right, there are no attractive forces, no repulsive forces, means an ideal gas cannot be liquefied. The liquefying concept is only for what? The real gas. So that is the reason why the ideal gas is a theoretical concept. There is no ideal gas as such. Okay. So how do we then understand the behavior of the real gases? So even in the beginning, right, at the conclusion of the gas laws, we have seen this equation PV is equal to nRT. So remember, you know, we have kept on mentioning there that this is the ideal gas equation. Only the ideal gases satisfy it. Real gases show deviation, like that we have mentioned. So what is the deviation that the real gases will show? And is there an equation for the real gas behavior? Yes, there is an equation. And that will come from some modification that we will do for the ideal gas equation. So we are going to modify the ideal gas equation, and that is what we will be calling as the real gas equation or the van der Waals equation. So the real gas equation or van der Waals equation will actually tell us the behavior of the real gases. So we'll see how the van der Waals equation is arrived at. Before we go into those details, right, let us try and see how we can understand the deviation shown by the real gases from the so-called ideal behavior. Look at this, you know, the Boyle's law relation. What is the Boyle's law relation? If you maintain the temperature constant for a given amount of gas, number of moles fixed, pressure into volume will be remaining constant irrespective of the pressure or the volume value. PV should be a constant. Like you see here, this is what the ideal gas, PV should be constant, the Boyle's law equation. But look at this, no, the so-called real gases, what are those? Carbon monoxide, methane, hydrogen, helium, what they are doing? They are not having the PV to be constant, they are showing deviation. So this is a way in which we can see the deviation of the normal gases, the real gases, from the ideal behavior. But there is a better way to study the deviation. That is by using the compressibility factor value. What is the compressibility for any gas, right? The ratio of PV to the nRT, that is what we call as a compressibility factor, represented by the symbol Z. Now you might think, so why are we talking about PV by nRT? Look at this now. The PV is equal to nRT is only for what? Ideal gases. So which means if you bring the nR to the left side, right, what is PV by nRT for the ideal gases? 1. That is the reason why Z is equal to 1 for the ideal gases. You can see here, Z we are plotting with respect to pressure. What is it for the ideal gas? It is what? 1. If you look at the real gases, you can see carbon dioxide, you can just take the green color one. At low pressure, the value of Z is less than 1. If you increase the pressure, means you can see here, the Z is becoming more than 1, which means for the real gases, Z can be less than 1, Z can be more than 1. What is the significance of Z less than 1? What is significance of Z more than 1? For that, what we'll do is, let us look at a real gas. We'll take a pressure P, temperature T, and some number of moles. the volume of the real gas, let us say the volume is V real. Similarly, we will take an ideal gas under identical conditions. Pressure is same, temperature is same, number of moles same. The volume is what? The volume in case of ideal gas. Now, if you look at the ideal gas rate, pressure into volume of the ideal by nRT, this is what? 1. That is, for the ideal gases, that is equal to 1. Now, if the real gas we are taking, Z less than 1. For the real gas, what is Z? Look at this, what is Z? P into the volume of the real gas by nRT. Z less than 1 means what? The volume of the real gas is less than the volume of the ideal. That is when Z will be less than 1, right? So here Z less than 1 means what? The real gas volume is less than the ideal gas volume. When it will be lesser, think about it. When the real gas particles are attracting each other, that is when the total volume will be lesser than the ideal case. So Z less than 1 represents what? Attractive forces that are going to dominate. And this is also what we call as, because the volume of the real gas is lesser than the ideal volume, right? That is why we call it as what? The negative deviation. What is the other side? If the real gas volume is more than the ideal, then in that case Z will be more than 1. So that indicates what? When the volume of the real gas will be more than the ideal gas, when the molecules are repelling each other. So Z more than 1 indicates what? The repulsive force is dominating. This is also what we call as the positive deviation. Why? Because the volume of the real gas is more than the volume of the ideal. Now, for example, if you take carbon dioxide, right? At low pressure means what? The molecules are fairly apart. So they will attract each other. So which means what? Attractive force dominate. You can see when attractive force dominate, Z will be what? Less than 1. But if you take the pressure to be very high means what? The particles will be compressed together, which means they will now start repelling. So look at it. When the pressure is very high means Z will be what? More than 1. So this is how we can see how Z is related to the pressure. Low pressure means, for most of them except for hydrogen, right? Hydrogen, we can see that Z is always more than 1. Okay. But for the others, we can see that Z at low pressure means what? Z is less than 1. High pressure means Z is becoming more than 1. That is because of the low pressure means the molecules are fairly far apart. They only can attract each other. That is when we have the attractive force dominating. If Z is more than 1, when it will come? When the pressure is very high. So the particles are compressed together. So they only then repel each other. So this is how the variation of Z can be correlated to the pressure. And the deviation of any real gas from the ideal behavior is understood by using the compressibility factor concept. Okay. Now, talking about how do we explain this in terms of an equation. So we said the real gas molecules themselves occupy volume and also have a restricted volume around them where the other particles cannot enter. Like, look at this. Now, this is one particle, means it is having some restricted volume, that red color dot. Into that volume, the other particles cannot enter. So here we will say constant B. This is what we call as the Van der Waals. So this is what we call as the Van der Waals volume constant B. This is also called as the co-volume. So this is what the restricted volume for one mole of the gas particles, B. If you have n number of moles, means how much will be the restricted volume? N into B. So if V is the contained volume, from that we have to subtract N into B. This is what? This is the free volume available for the movement of the gas particles. So from the entire container volume V, we have to subtract N into B. So here what is B? B is called as co-volume. That is, you know, the total restricted volume for one mole of the gas particles. Since we say N number of moles, means we have to subtract N into B. This is about the volume correction. You can see here the volume correction is a negative correction because there is some volume which is not available for the free movement of the gas particles. That is why we have to subtract that part. Now, the other thing is about the pressure correction. So what is the pressure correction? We will see. So if we talk about the pressure correction, right? Look at a particle which is just about to, so let's say this is the wall. The particle is about to go and collide. When it is about to collide, right? it is getting farther from the other peripheral, like the other peripheral particles are here, it is getting farther and farther from them. So what happens when they're going far away means they will start attracting. So this particle which is just about to collide is being like a, in a way it is like, you know, it is being pulled back. So it is going and hitting, and that is what will give us the pressure, the measured pressure. But if the backward pulling is not there, right, the particle would have gone and hit with an even more stronger impact, which means in ideal case the pressure would have been more than this value. If you are registering a pressure P for oxygen gas, if the oxygen gas is not behaving like a real one, if it is like ideal one, right, the pressure would have been a higher value, because if nobody is pulling me from back means I can go and hit the, the particle can go and hit the wall with more impact. So which means the pressure correction here we will do as an additive correction. So this is what the ideal equivalent pressure. Okay, so here you can see there is a constant A that you are keeping. So to pressure we are adding An square by V square. This A is what we will be calling as the van der Waals pressure constant. And obviously the A is going to represent what? The strength of the intermolecular forces. The pressure is affected by what? What is the strength of the force between the particles, right? So A is going to represent the strength of the intermolecular forces. Higher the value of A means what? More stronger are the intermolecular forces. Lesser value of A means what? The intermolecular forces are weaker. So B represents the restricted volume available for the, B represents what? The restricted volume, which is nothing but the actual volume of the particles plus some additional volume which is forbidden. A represents strength of intermolecular forces. Not only that, like if you look at the modified van der Waals equation, right? So what is it? The modified pressure term into modified volume is equal to what? nRT. This is what we call as the van der Waals equation. So what is this? This is the van der Waals equation. Now here, right, we can have some different scenarios. Like if it is 1 mole of the gas means simply put n is equal to 1. Look at this. What is the equation going to become? P plus A by V square, because n will be 1, into V minus B is equal to RT. And also we can expect questions on what will be the units of A, what will be the dimensional formula of A, what will be the units of B, what will be the dimensional formula of B, like that. So look at it. If you have the pressure correction term, we are adding An square by V square to P, which means pressure and An square by V square should have the same units. Means A unit should be what? P into V square by N square. Pressure is atm. V, if you take liter, right, liter square divided by mole square, means it will be what? Mole power minus 2. Similarly, we can even be asked to find what is the dimensional formula for that. The same time about the B also, the van der Waals volume constant. So we are doing V minus NB means V and NB should have the same units. So the unit of B will be what? V by N. V is liter, N is mole. So it will be what? Liter per mole. So like this, again here also, they can ask us what is the dimensional formula. Same concept, right? How do you get the dimensional formula? Using the equation. You will substitute the dimensions of all the other quantities. We will get what is the dimensions of A and what is the dimensions of B. Okay, so this is about the van der Waals gas constants. Now the real gas, right, as we said before, has got the property of getting liquefied. Ideal gas cannot be liquefied. So if you look at the real gases, right, take for example, we have the gaseous phase. We keep on decreasing the temperature. We'll first convert into what? Liquid. Then we'll convert into solid. So as you can see here, we have a solid phase, liquid phase and gaseous phase. The conditions of temperature and pressure where a substance can exist in all the three states, we'll say coexist. That is called as what? Triple point. That is one important point on the phase diagram. The other one is, you see here, there is a temperature here. Beyond this, after the temperature, right, no matter how much ever pressure we apply, the gas cannot be liquefied. After this critical point, right, the temperature, which we are going to call as critical temperature, no matter how much ever pressure we apply, the gas cannot be liquefied. This temperature is going to be called as what? The critical temperature. Now, critical temperature, right, is going to be indicating the strength of intermolecular forces. So if say for example I have a gas A and gas B, gas A critical temperature is 500 Kelvin, gas B it is 700 Kelvin, means gas B I can even liquefy up to 700 Kelvin. Means what? In gas B case the intermolecular force are stronger, that is why even at high temperature, because temperature increasing means what? The particles will try to go away. So even at 700 I am able to liquefy, means what? The gas B intermolecular force are what? Stronger. So remember, critical temperature higher value means what? That indicates the intermolecular forces for the gas will be high, and that also means what? That particular gas can be easily liquefied. So like this also we can expect some questions. Okay, so look at this, the critical parameters is what we call it as. The critical temperature is what? It is the temperature above which a gas cannot be liquefied. Okay, it is what? It is the temperature above which a gas cannot be liquefied, or we can say what? No gas can be liquefied. Okay, now what is the value of this critical temperature in terms of the van der Waals constants? It is what? 8 a by 27 rb. What is the TC value? 8 a by 27 rb. So higher critical temperature would mean what? The gas can be easily liquefied, and also would mean what? The strength of the intermolecular force are stronger. That is what is the significance of the higher critical temperature. The other critical parameter is the critical pressure. So basically on the phase diagram, right, the corresponding pressure that is needed to liquefy the gas at critical temperature, right, that is what is called as the critical pressure. Okay, so like you see here, this is the phase diagram, right, the corresponding pressure here, that is what we call as the critical pressure. So what is the value of this in terms of van der Waals constants? A by 27 b square. Now if you take volume occupied by one mole of the gas at critical temperature and pressure, because volume will depend upon number of moles, that volume is going to be called as what? The critical volume. So remember one thing, critical volume is for one mole. What is the value of this? 3b. Now we talked about the compressibility factor Z. If you look at the critical conditions, what is the compressibility factor formula? PV by nRT, right? So here volume will be taking for one mole, so P critical, volume critical, number of moles is 1, right, into RT critical. So what is it? P critical V critical by R into T critical. Okay, so look at this, we'll have to substitute the values. What is critical pressure? A by 27 B square. Critical volume is what? 3 B. R into, what is the critical temperature? 8 A by 27 R B. If you check it, right, so everything will get cancelled. We are just going to be having what? 3 by 8. So still we can see that this is what? Less than 1. Less than 1 means the attractive forces are still dominating. That is why we can still liquefy the gas. Okay, so here, you know, this can be a straight theoretical question. What is the value of compressibility factor of a gas at the critical conditions? What is the answer for this? It is 3 by 8. Okay, so this is about the kinetic theory of gases, but mostly from the JE perspective, right, we can look at the internal energy of the gas part, the results of the kinetic theory of gases, the kinetic gas equation, and velocities distribution, I mean the velocity distribution graph, I mean not in terms of the equation as such, but in terms of the results, the velocity formulas, etc. That is where we might have to give a little bit more focus. And of course the first part, which is about the gas laws part and the macro behavior, and even the last part, the real gas behavior, right, these things we do get to know the coherence in terms of the chemistry states of matter chapter. So in the van der Waals equation also comes in chemistry as well. Okay, so this is about the kinetic theory of gases, and we will see in the next chapter.